Noa, Department of Economics, where she also received her PhD in economics. Her research lies at the intersection of applied microeconometrics, gender, health, migration, and development economics. Her recent publications include Heterogeneity in the Inter-Household Allocation of International Remittances, Evidence from Filipino Households, and The Role of Remittances as a Risk Coping Mechanism, Evidence from Agricultural Households in Rural Philippines. The lecture will run for 40 minutes and will be followed by a 20-minute open forum where questions from the audience will be entertained. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, let us all welcome Dr. Marjorie Pajaron.
Good afternoon, everyone. See if this works. This one's on the... Yes. So my paper, the research that I'm going to present today, is about the impact of energy access on women's health, labor, and time allocation. It's funded by EPDP. Actually, if you have questions while I'm presenting, you can ask your questions. I don't mind. So, let's make this sort of informal. Okay, so for the outline, this is what I'm going to follow. So first, I'm going to do some introduction and then present the motivation of the paper, a brief review of related literature, and discuss how this research stacks up, relative to the existing literature. And then discuss the data used in econometric methodology, the results and conclusion. Okay, so introduction. Okay, so please indulge me. I'm sure most of you, if not all, are familiar with the role of energy, but I'm just going to present nonetheless to motivate the paper. Okay, so we all know that a well-established energy system is very important to not just ensuring economic growth, but also human development and sustainable development. Okay? In fact, we know that energy supports different sectors in the economy. Okay, and it makes our everyday lives function smoothly and develop effectively. In fact, in 2015, the United Nations, having recognized the role of energy in sustainable development, made access to not just energy, but four attributes of energy. So access to affordable, reliable, sustainable, and modern energy for all, as part of its 2030 sustainable development, making this access to this four attributes of energy part one of its 17 development goals. Okay? But just like any other, the rest of the goals, this goal has issues attached to it. Okay? From supply to access to consumption of energy. So let's first look at the issue pertaining to consumption of energy. In China, based on the literature by Ding and others, an excessive consumption of biomass energy resulted to soil erosion and degradation of organic substances in soil and also ecological environmental disruption. When we say biomass energy, we mean any one of this wood, lung, crop residues, and straw. Okay, and then UN in 2018 reported that about 2.8 billion people still depend on renewable energy, such as fuel, wood, charcoal, and biomass residues. In the Philippines, according to HEX, Household Energy Consumption Survey 2011, at least 4 hour consumption of energy in terms of cooking fuel, half of the household survey use fuel wood. And then 40% LPG, as you can see. And then the smallest percentage is 20% of the households depend on biomass residues. Okay, with respect to access to modern energy. Okay, so although the trend in global consumption of electricity has been increasing over time, still the United Nations in 2016 reported that about 1 in 5 people still did not have access to electricity, or about 1.2 billion people. In the Philippines, do you know the percentage of households that have electricity? About 87%. Okay. This electricity is primarily used for lighting. Okay. Okay, so in developing countries that do not have access to electricity, they have to resort to other sources of energy. And most of the time, to be able to acquire these other sources of energy, it takes a lot of time, and it is sometimes difficult to acquire and manage. And so, I'm going to insert gender into this discussion by saying that traditionally, it's the role of women to acquire and manage these other sources of energy, okay, such as when they instead use fuel wood, then the women are the ones responsible for acquiring fuel wood, for cooking, and also managing the households, which expose them to several health hazards. Household. First, let's look at the existing literature. Okay, in India, women, on average, take about 30 kilometers a month just to acquire wood, or about 2.7 hours per trip. Okay, just to collect fuel wood, and sometimes traversing the terrain, often in high altitudes, resulting to health conditions. So what are these health conditions? So stiff neck, for example, you can just see, no? Stiff neck and then migraine. And loss of productive workdays, because they could have been working or engaging in micro-enterprises instead of acquiring wood. And then, the use of inefficient solid fuels for cooking, for example, also resulted to premature death. Okay, about 4.3 million people due to illnesses. For example, 6% of the deaths due to lung cancer, 34% attributed to stroke. Okay. Questions? Okay. So, women and their children are actually the ones most susceptible to these health hazards, primarily because, as I've said, it's women who manage and acquire, for example, fuel wood, and then cook fuel wood in a poorly ventilated homes, resulting to indoor pollution and resulting to illnesses that I've just shown. In fact, according to a study by Pajaron, women exposed to indoor pollution or indoor smoke are 3 times more likely to suffer from COPD. What is COPD? Chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, such as chronic bronchitis, emphysema, relative to women who cook using cleaner energy sources, such as LPG, for example, or electricity. So given this, the motivation of this paper is to examine the role of energy access to, or the impact of energy access to the health of women or mothers, their labor force, and time allocation, using Cebu Longitudinal Health and Nutrition Survey, CLHNS. The reason why we've decided to use CLHNS is because we could construct panel data. And the balanced panel data that we could construct is from 1994 to 2005, although the survey is from 1983 to 2009, covering 3 generations. So we take advantage of panel data analysis in order to address several identification issues that wouldn't have been addressed had we used cross-sectional data. For example, time invariant and observed household fixed effects. Also, using a panel data such as CLHNS will provide a more accurate relationship of energy access and the welfare outcomes that we want to measure. Also, it will provide a richer analysis and more nuanced understanding of the importance of access to affordable, modern, and sustainable energy. And then it's sort of an exploration. So it's interesting to analyze the changing energy access over time and also the accompanying changes in time allocation, and also whether the health of women improved or whether they participated more in the labor market because of better energy access, a safer energy access. And I'd like to also point out that most of the studies that examine the impact of insufficient and inefficient access to energy on women mostly focus on other countries. For example, Africa, South Asia, and China. Questions? Okay. So for review of related literature, I decided to organize the review of related literature into three sections. One, looking at the relationship of energy, poverty, health, and gender, the role of women in clean energy, and the Philippine case. Okay, so the role of income in the choice of energy or cooking fuel. In the poor and developing countries mostly use traditional sources of energy. And compared to higher income households or higher income groups, they relatively use less energy. Okay? Gender also plays a role in the decision regarding energy access. As I said, no, for low income and rural households in developing countries, it's the role of women. No, to manage energy. For example, acquiring fuel, wood, cooking, and providing energy. However, it's the male heads who decide on the types of fuel use and the budget allocation. So finances, and then the final decision on the type of fuel, okay, and the purchase of different energy-based equipment. Okay, so there's sort of imbalance in the roles. Okay, so to address this gender aspect of the energy poverty nexus, there are some suggestions. Two suggestions. One, empower women, and second, change the supply side of energy. How do you change the supply side of energy? One is, according to a study by Dane, switching to photovoltaic devices. Okay, or solar powered lighting could save women time and effort, so they don't have to traverse the trains just to collect fuel, for example. Also, switching to electricity can improve women's welfare. Okay, frees up women from household production, and therefore they're more able to engage in micro enterprises. In India, electrification doesn't just improve women's chances of participating in the labor market, but also improving the enrollment rates of children, boys and girls. So this fifth one just supports the third one. So we think empowering women is also also translates to enabling them to engage in small and medium scale enterprises. Okay, so what is the role of women in clean energy? In Indonesia, if women are the decision makers, the households are more able to save energy and therefore less consumption of energy. Also, shifting to renewable forms of energy not only makes the tasks of women less labor intensive, but also mitigate the adverse effect of using inefficient energy, causing air pollution.
Also, they
found that women prefer technologies that have less health hazards compared to men. Okay? And in the Philippines, there are three papers looking at the role of or the links between electricity use, for example, poverty by MAPA and others. And then by Uganda Quick, they found that there's a relationship between energy use, gender, and weather variability.
And consistent with the
existing literature,
it's the women who are most vulnerable
to weather variation. And then finally, Kapuno found that the use of electricity and cleaner energy improve the health of children. Okay, so for data that we use, as I said, we use Salish-NS. So you're all familiar with Salish-NS. So it's a simple data gathering information about the socioeconomic and demographic information of mothers in 1983, and then tracing them up until their children and their grandchildren. Okay, so tracing three generations. The independent variables that we use are divided into three. One is household energy access, whether the households use electricity and lighting source, and then the type of cooking fuel used. For outcome variables, like I said, we have health, labor, and then time allocation. So I'm just going to show, I don't know if it's clear, the variables that we use. For health, we use four, so we're just going to present four. Whether the mother has had diabetes, heart disease, cancer, tuberculosis in the past week or year. In terms of labor force, whether the mother worked for pay, self-employed, wage-employed, or unpaid family workers. This is the time allocation we've divided into 10, okay, including sleeping, okay? So, here you can see hygiene, food preparation, childcare, housekeeping, and then work from home, work outside, recreational, and schooling. And then this is our, the variables that we use for energy access. Okay, so for data description, we just want to show that for 1994 to 2005, the incidence of diabetes increased, okay, among mothers, and also the incidence of heart disease. And then so that it's not too boring, I'm just going to present figures instead, no? Instead of the tables that I just showed. Okay, for mothers working for pay, by 1998, 78% of mothers worked for pay, and this declined ever since. For employment status, most of the mothers by 2005 were self-employed, no? Rather than wage employees. But at the beginning, more mothers were wage employed and less self-employed. For different time allocation, you can see that the highest percentage of time allocation is on activity working outside. Okay? So about 8 hours of their time spent on working outside, about 6 hours on average among mothers work from home, and then recreational. Schooling is decreasing. Why? Obviously, this has the age effect, no? Because I presume that by the time that their grandmothers, they're not already in school. But still a small percentage. Okay, in terms of cooking fuel, we've seen that the cooking fuel, actually, by 2005, more households or more mothers use wood, about 48%. No? And then LPG uses
beneficiaries are about 34.2%, care receiving about 16%, and then other sources such as Sundance Park remain the same.
Obviously, most of the households in Cebu or mothers belonging households lit up electricity by 2005, about 91.4%. Kerosene users for use for lighting dramatically decreased. And for households with electricity by 2005, about 93% of mothers live in households with electricity. Questions? Okay, for the American model, very basic. So for the three outcomes, labor force, labor outcomes, health outcomes, and time allocation, we use fixed effects and random effects. Okay? Why did we use fixed effects and random effects? Because as I said, we wanted to address the unobserved heterogeneity across households, that is type invariant. So we want to eliminate this using fixed effects. Random effects is another way of addressing this. Okay, so you use random effects when this is uncorrelated with the independent variables, right? And then another way to measure this is just probability analysis. The same strategy we use for health, and then for time allocation, instead of using probability, we use GLM because GLM, aside from, so we converted minutes into percentage of time allocated relative to the entire time that the mother has in a day. Okay? So if you convert this into percentage, then GLM is the more apt methodology.
Marjorie, how did you define energy access?
I don't know. Type of cooking fuel.
Dummy variable.
Yes.
One,
for example, if they have electricity, zero otherwise. One, if they use LPG, zero otherwise. Relative to wood, for example. Okay. So what do you think is the result? For health, these are the regressions that we ran. Pero obviously, I'm not going to present that. I'm just going to show these numbers. Okay. What do the results suggest? One, simple enough. Wood users are more exposed to health hazards. Okay, relative to when they use electricity. Okay, so women who use wood are 1.5% more likely to have cancer relative to those who use electricity, and about 0.6% more likely to have TB compared to those who use kerosene cooking fuel. This is using fixed effects. The results are robust if we use other methodology like random effects and probability. For random effects, we found that those who use kerosene are about 0.5% more likely to have TB, 0.5% less likely to have TB relative to wood users. And those who use LPG are also about 0.8% less likely to have TB compared to wood users. Okay? Sorry.
Yeah. Do you have a control variable of income? Because obviously, if you have access to electricity, you must be higher income compared to the one looking for wood.
Yes.
That Bahrain disease would be correlated more.
Oh. It's actually one of the issues of the paper. Because the LHS doesn't have income, it doesn't have a wage variable. We can only use proxy, for example. And in assuming that those who have electricity are higher income.
Unless the chemical properties would really is there's even appealing.
Yes. Well, actually, it's consistent with the literature because if they use wood, then there's indoor pollution.
Okay.
If the home, especially if the homes are hand well ventilated.
Maybe it's both.
Oh, when did it begin?
Yeah.
But given that we don't have income, so probably the results are influenced by the income effect also. And that's what we're cautious about in the interview. It's the smoke from the wood. Like for example, you saw results in other countries. Women who are exposed to smoke are three times more likely to have chronic bronchitis.
That one, I think, also in those other countries, it's a little delay, right?
Mm-hmm.
The pollution is probably worse than our high
cold weather.
Yes.
You put inversion
on the hand. No, the smoke is still.
Yes, the results are also country specific and culture specific. But still, the smoke can happen, unfortunately.
Is there an instance where it's a mixed type, like 50%
use of electricity? Yes, we consider that this is a mix. 50% LPG users and then 40%. It doesn't sum to 100. So there are cases when, according to my health, it's possible that they use LPG and then for grilling they use charcoal. So it's possible, but for now we haven't considered international, just independent, individual impact. Any questions? Okay. And then, women that use kerosene for lighting relative to electricity are about 0.8% more likely to have cancer. When we run probing, it has a very high result, high magnitude. So women using LPG or women using wood are about 68% more likely to have TB than those who use cleaner cooking fuel, like LPG.
Probably the
yes, yes. Probably because of that. Okay, in terms of labor, so I'm just going to present the results that make sense. There's some results that are inconsistent with the literature. But for now, I'm just going to show you the ones that are consistent with the literature. Okay. One, those who use electricity for lighting are more likely to be working for me. Okay, so because it frees up their time from food preparation, for example, gathering fuel, wood, and therefore they have more time to work. Okay. That's we use fixed effects. Also, if they use LPG relative to wood, they are more likely to work, to be self-employed. Okay. Again, this is consistent with the literature that says that women who use cleaner energy or more efficient energy have more free time to engage in microenterprises. The same with random effects. So the fixed effects and random effects are just robust results. And then the same with probing. So again, LPG users versus wood users. LPG users are more likely to work for wood. Whether we use random effects, fixed effects, or probing. Okay, for time allocation, again, some of the results are not consistent with the literature, but again, the ones that I'm showing are the ones that are consistent so far. Okay, so let's start with the not consistent one. My expectation actually is that wood users, because they need more time to prepare food, will actually have less time taking care of their children. However, in the results, at least for random effects and fixed effects,